All right, this video is to tell you to not wake up. Don't try to wake up. Do everything you can to avoid waking up. It's not an option. It's for the person that has no other option possible left. The person that is completely hopeless and in full-out depression mode. That's when enlightenment comes for you. You can't make it. You can't manifest it. You can't even speak of it until you actually see through and you have no other option. No human on earth possibly wants enlightenment. It's not what you think and believe it to be. It is in the total opposite direction. Avoid it at all costs. That's my advice. Like, literally, that is my advice. Keep going about your life, trying to get your desires, fighting, doing whatever you need to do. This is not what you think it is. This is not what you want. Nobody wants this. The only thing it will give you is vision. It will not give you money. It will not give you fame. It will not give you anything. It will only give you clarity. So if you're sick of being a lie, fine. If you're okay with it, if you still have those energetic powers, then go with those. Just, this video is kind of the knife twist for what you're about to endure if you already passed over the line of no return.
Zen and the Art of Self-Mutilation. This is adapted from a letter Jed McKenna wrote in reply to a self-professed serious seeker who made an impassioned offer to turn over his belongings and himself in exchange for being accepted as Jed's student. Dear William, you don't need to add me to your equation. You need to subtract yourself. Begin by re-examining your assumptions. It's clear from your letter that you consider yourself a serious person, a serious seeker. That's the first assumption you'll want to challenge. You're sure that a serious seeker is what you are, and you think, I see you that way too. But this is not the case. I know Sirius when I see it, and I know a hand puppet of Maya when I see it. You think you're on top of something, but the only thing to be on top of is Maya. And she's on top of you like a house on a mouse. This may appear to be the ultimate sacrifice, a grand act of selflessness, but it's really the ultimate entrenchment. Fear gone haywire, ego solidifying its hold for decades to come. This isn't how you surrender the self. This is how you abandon it, abdicate responsibility for your own life. I understand this can be a very tempting response to a very perplexing challenge. Nevertheless, your gesture suggests that you're in an uncomfortable place. Good for you. That's always the best place to be. Being so uncomfortable means you'll soon have to move. That's good. That's the motivation that drives the journey of awakening. It's a series of steps, none taken voluntarily, all necessitated by the kind of discomfort that causes you to write your letter to me. The motivation behind your letter is good, but throwing yourself at me is not a solution. What would I do with you? What possible instruction could I give? Maybe I would tell you to cut off 1 ounce of your body every day until you can answer the question, what is true? Any ounce, as long as it's an ounce. That should bring you quickly into focus, light a fire under you. If you had to do this, cut off 1 ounce of your body every day, how much time do you think you would waste on meditation? On attending satsang or reading the latest spiritual bestseller? Not bloody much. You would soon become an enlightenment machine. Sleep and food would be reduced to barest minimums. Relationships and activities once deemed essential would be forgotten. You would enter into a burning mania of single-pointedness. Soon, anything other than the question, what is true, would seem comically irrelevant. There's your new Zen. Zen for the new millennium. It would be interesting to see how many sand gardens and books of pithy aphorisms the self-mutilation approach sells. What is true? That's the only koan there is. The only one anyone ever needs. Every day you don't answer this question, another ounce. Take a moment to think about what it would mean to have to sit down with a scalpel at a certain time every day and amputate 1 ounce of your body. You would quickly have to learn things about asking and answering, about how the process works and doesn't work, about how to help it and how to get out of its way. You would have to learn how to unlearn, and you would need access to a tremendous amount of resources in order to accomplish such an unlearning. You would discard clever spiritual concepts for cold facts, pretty Eastern vocabulary for words of scientific precision. The process is one of seeing clearly, not just blindly lashing out. That act of seeing clearly takes time and resources, and the mind must work almost ceaselessly at levels far beyond the everyday. Would this work? Well, let's say it did. Say it worked in 500 days. There you are after hacking off over 30 pounds of yourself. And now your truth realized. Now you know directly, for yourself, without the slightest possibility of error, the truth. You are free from delusion, awakened from the dream state. You have joined the ranks of the spiritually enlightened. You look at your toeless feet, fingerless hands, noseless face, earless head, and what would you say? Here's what you'd say. Well, that was kind of dumb. I'm happy to tell you that right up front. Waking up is kind of dumb. There's no point. It's not merely pointless. It's pointlessness. Who would do such a thing? Only someone who absolutely couldn't not do it. Once you become the person that can't not do it, it's a whole different thing. But trying to do it before you absolutely must is as ludicrous as slicing off parts of your body. Which, by the way, don't do. As barbaric and unthinkable as this ounce-a-day approach may seem, I can assure you that anyone who has ever managed to awaken from the dream state was driven by equally unendurable mental and emotional forces. Something to consider the next time you hear the pop guru du jour recount the moment of his glorious epiphany. I was walking in the park. Children were laughing. Birds were singing. When all of a sudden... Many people can build nuclear reactors, compose symphonies, conquer nations, or perform brain surgery, but very few can see what is. Your spirituality is just another false garment, another layer of the lie of self. Your spirituality defines the dimensions of your cell, and the fact that you don't see that tells me that you have no idea where you are or whose rules you are living under. You have no grasp of your true situation, of the nature of your captive status. You're clinging desperately to your lies, shielding them with emotional energy. Why? Because these lies are you. They are who you are. You don't have imperfections. You are imperfections. Ask yourself why you even write to me. What's the point? None of what I'm saying is new to you. And yet, here you are, writing impassioned letters to me, trying to stand your lies back up on their feet. Who you are is a lie. That's a fact.
So you can see why I don't want anyone to have to do this or go through this. There's no point. It's complete pointlessness. The only thing you get is clear seeing and vision. That's all you get. You don't get the things you want. The very act of wanting is the opposite. This is for people that have absolutely no other option than to get real and figure out what's going on. It's not that you commit suicide, it's that your spirit commits suicide. Your emotional thought, physical, your reality, all of that is what dies. The only thing left is the truth after that. So instead of trying to make lies stand up, you let them die, you let them burn. The fire is what remains. The fire within you is the thing that takes care of all of the lies. Consciousness takes care of all of the lies. Trying to sell your illusion of selfhood to the world around you, it's a game, and it gets played until you can't possibly play it any longer. There's one more video I want to show here. It's a Truman Show example here. And it's super, 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 super accurate.
The movie is a basic parable of the journey of...
from delusion. At the end of his journey, Truman Burbank escapes through the final door into... It is a basic parable of the journey of awakening from delusion. At the end of his journey, Truman Burbank escapes through the final door into freedom from the artificial environment, Sea Haven, in which he was raised. He steps through the door into a broader reality that is essentially the same world he's always known, but on a larger scale. Same paradigm, same dynamics, same everything, really, just one level up. Just like Neo in The Matrix, Truman doesn't escape from Maya. He just leaps from one turtle to the next. So, pretend it's you opening that door. Your whole life has been moving toward this. You've undergone crisis after crisis, fought battle after battle, destroyed illusion after illusion. You've been living in a state of unrelenting emotional upheaval as your world collapses around you. You've made a great journey, and now you're about to discover the truth of your being. You're about to leave the only reality you've ever known and step into a new, bigger reality you've never seen and only recently began to suspect. In the movie metaphor, Truman is just stepping out of a microcosm into the regular cosm we all know. It's really the same paradigm he's known in the vast soundstage of Sea Haven, but on a different scale. He's just tunneling from one cell into a larger cell. But what if, instead of standing at a door to the next level, he was standing at the final door, a door that wouldn't open into just another layer, but beyond all layers and into the ultimate, eternal, and infinite reality? What if he'd killed his final Buddha, took his final bow, and stepped through that door into the perfect void of nothing forever? There's no time or space on the other side of that final door, no energy or matter, no motion, no relativeness, no otherness. The mountain is not a mountain. There are no people or places out there, no character to play or audience to play to. It's all truth and no Truman. There's nothing to perceive, so there's no perception. And without perceived and perception, how can there be a perceiver? Standing at that final door isn't like anything. It's the end of the line. The final question is destroyed. The final veil is drawn back. The final gate is opened. Everything is understood. Perfect knowledge is attained because all false knowledge has been destroyed. He has arrived at the only place in Maya's universe where there is no further, a strange and lonely place called Dunn. All he can do now is turn around and re-enter the false reality he gave everything to escape. Only now he is, quite literally, disillusioned. And there it is. The enlightened guy is really just a bad sport who stomped off in a black rage and then slinks back after discovering that there's nowhere else to go. I called enlightenment a booby prize, and this is why. But truth realization isn't achieved by desire, so it's only those who can't get there that would be disappointed. The black rage guy didn't want to become something true. He wanted to unbecome something false. In the movie, the last thing Truman does before going through that door is kill the Buddha. He kills God, his God. He's killed everyone else, destroyed every other lie and delusion, and only this last barrier remains. For Truman, it's Christoff, his creator slash director slash producer. For anyone, killing that final whatever and opening that final door are two ways of saying the same thing. Done. Note that Truman did not make a spiritual journey. He wasn't a practitioner of any technique or follower of any path. He had no teacher or lineage. He was simply someone who detected a loose thread in the fabric of his reality and began tugging on it, and had the purity of intent necessary to keep on tugging, even though the thing he was unraveling was himself. After you make the great journey, a journey of surmounting obstacles and confronting fears, of unmasking deceivers, of burning everything, of arriving at that final gate and killing that final Buddha, of beholding the infinite truth directly. After all that, then what? Then done. Then you pull the door shut and leave all that truth void shit out there where it belongs. Then you know. Then you understand. Then the house lights are thrown on and the whole tragicomic farce is revealed. And you'll never be able to really suspend disbelief again. Then the artificial environment you went to such lengths to get out of would be looking pretty sweet, and escape would be looking pretty dumb, like breaking out of a submarine or a spaceship. Movie Truman steps through the door and leaves his Sea Haven behind, but our oxymoronic Truman doesn't go through the door. He can't. There's no such thing as him anywhere else. He's discovered that he's a prisoner in protective custody, a holodeck character who can't exist outside of his holographic environment. He's still on the stage. But now the illusion has been shattered. No more meaning, nothing left to do, just a whole lot of whatever. So, in the movie, Truman passes through the door and the credits roll. But in our final door version, he does not go out. He turns around and goes back in. What is this new person that returns from the final door back into the vast soundstage of Sea Haven? Is he magically endowed? Is he a mystic? Does he have special powers? Can he grant boons? There's nothing different in his appearance. He doesn't glow or levitate or radiate benevolence. He doesn't spew wisdom or have a sagely answer to every question. He doesn't know any shortcuts to the final door or why anyone would want to get there. He is, as Layman Pang said, neither holy nor wise, just an ordinary fellow who has completed his work. What a true Truman returns to find is a Sea Haven full of actors. What he once saw as people like himself are now something else, something bewildering and unrelatable. One thing he knows is that they don't know what he knows. They haven't undergone those personal unravelings and stood at that final door. They haven't made the ultimate journey from which return itself is an illusion. They don't know where they are. So what, at most, are they? Children? Straw dogs? Zombies? None of them, to our Truman's clear new eyes, better or worse than another. Not bad, not good, just asleep at most, and non-sentient apparitions at least. They are set design, props, extra. He is no longer one of them, or related to them, and never will be again. Movie Truman walks out of Sea Haven into a new life of love and freedom. But our true man is now consigned to walk alone in a world that he knows is not real, cloaked in a body and persona to which he feels no connection, surrounded by actors playing a pointless drama. He has traded everything for nothing.
In case I don't see you. Good afternoon, good evening, and good night.
So that's kind of what it is. That's what waking up is. Jim Carrey did lots of movies, you know, like that, that are analogous to the waking up process. And if we look at Jim Carrey, he's been outcasted and shushed and treated pretty shittily. You know, he has a lot of followers, but he doesn't get much likes or comments or anything. He's just drawing, trying to show the picture himself the way he sees it, unfiltered. He's a good dude, man. Yeah, that Truman Show, I mean, if you look at it, you'll see everyone's just acting, and you've been acting as well your whole life. None of it was ever real. It was all just fictitious bullshit. Like, I literally sit here and I get nothing. I get nothing to say, there's nothing to speak, there's nothing to know about this. I'm back in, and I'm ready to play along. I'm just making the point in point world. Everybody wants to make points in point land. I am awake, I am enlightened, I am done. I can't go further, I can't delete self any further. You cannot become self-aware until you unravel it layer by layer. It's like, it really is like shedding your own skin. Like, it will be the most unbearable pain and torture you could ever go through. But you will reach done, and you'll be shocked when you do reach done, because done is just done. It's over. It's a gateless gate. Watch one more video on Gateless Gate. Or not. Oh, I put it in wrong.
One must pass through the Gateless Gate. The gate refers to the barrier that stands between the unawakened mind and enlightenment. From the perspective of the person wishing to become enlightened, this gate appears enormous and impassable. It's what you see as the difference between you and me. I tend to think of it more as a series of doors, each of which must be unlocked and passed through before progress can continue. Until finally, the final door is opened and you look back on your great journey, only to find that you never moved an inch, and that there never was a gate, no doors, no locks, not so much as a line drawn in the sand. Oh, I see. And how is that useful? Good question. I think about it for a moment. I recall my own pre-enlightened thoughts about the gateless gate. I don't believe it is. It's just something you notice once you get past it. Oh, I see. And when they talk about a finger pointing at the moon? Okay. When they talk about a finger pointing at the moon, they're saying you should look where the finger's pointing, not at the finger itself. Don't mistake the finger for the moon. I see. And how is that useful? Well, for instance, if you were to start making a big deal about me, then I would use the finger pointing at the moon thing to get you back on the right track, to put your attention back where it belongs, on the moon, not the finger. Make sense? Yes, thank you. Reading about Zen lately, Mary? Yes, because you talk about it so much. Well, use the opportunity to sharpen your sword of discrimination. Much of what you'll read about Zen is a finger pointing at the finger pointing at the moon rather than at the moon. Keep that in mind, and let me know if you have more questions. Other questions come, and I deal with them. Kundalini, diet, psychedelic drugs, this movie, that book, this guru, that poem, this shortcut, that fad. I'm in a very relaxed state, but eventually the subject of bliss comes up and gets my juices flowing again.
All right, so I know that I started this with Don't Wake Up, but whatever, you're watching this. You probably already have the seed inserted, and it will grow like every idea does in one's mind. You take belief as far as you can, and then you take disbelief as far as you can. If you do both those things, you'll wake up. There's no stopping it.
One.
This dude, Alan Watts, I also recommend watching him. All his philosophical vantage points are amazingly accurate, so he's probably just an awake human saying it in less direct terms back in the 1950s and 60s. And there are tons of people watching his stuff on YouTube. Like, the views are usually in the hundreds of thousands, and it's increasing too, so that's kind of cool. But yeah, enlightenment is the dumbest, most boring thing possible, and that's why it doesn't get talked about, and there's no money in it, and there's no putting it into words. It's just not possible to put nothing into words, but here I am, trying to do it. Alright, that's probably it for this video. Do your own research, do your own waking up. I'm running out of stuff to say about it. Say nothing, do nothing, be nothing. It's a good practice for waking the fuck up. So I'm gonna do that by hitting stop. Later.